Thank you. Use of that access at home. So beginning tomorrow, you can come and get a candle, a communion packet, and a printed bulletin if you need it in the entryway of the church for Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve worship. So that's the preparation for Christmas Eve. You will receive an announcement in an email later today about that, and you will also receive that instruction in the email as well with the link on Christmas Eve. There's been no movement this week as far as the insurance claim and so forth, but we are still anticipating more information to come down the pike about that. My gut is that we probably won't hear much more about that until the new year, given everything that's going on. But we will keep you abreast if things should happen. Otherwise, let us now prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we light the Advent wreath.
That I have sinned by my own fault in thought, word, and
God Almighty to have mercy on me. Forgive me all my sins and bring me to everlasting life. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God does forgive us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by Christ's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The reading this morning is from 1 Samuel chapter 1. There was a man from the city of Great Vistas, from the hill country of the tribe of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah. He had two wives. The name of the first was Hannah, and the name of the second was Peninnah. Now Peninnah had children, but Hannah was childless. After some time, Hannah became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, thinking, "I asked the Lord for him." Once she had weaned him, she took him up with her along with three bulls, an ephah of flour, and a container of wine. She brought him to the Lord's house at Shiloh, even though he was young. Once the bull had been slaughtered, they brought the boy to Eli. She said, "Just as surely as you are alive, my Lord, I am the woman who previously stood here with you in order to pray to the Lord. I prayed for this boy, and the Lord has given me the request that I asked of him. Now I dedicate him to the Lord. From this time on, he is dedicated to the Lord," and they worship the Lord there. Hannah prayed and said, "My heart exalts in the Lord. My strength is exalted in my God. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in my victory. There is no holy one like the Lord. No one besides you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who are hungry are fat with spoil. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low, he also exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness, for not by might does one prevail. The Lord. His adversaries shall be shattered. The Most High will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the power of his anointed." The word of the Lord.
My soul
Christ is in God, my Savior.
For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant.
Surely from now on generations will call me blessed.
For the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name.
His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation.
Strength with his arm, he has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts.
He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly.
He has filled the hungry with good things
and sent the rich away empty.
He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy.
According to the promise he made to our ancestors and to Abraham and to his descendants forever. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom, of that there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called holy, and he will be called the Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren, for nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
find ourselves today on a threshold of sorts. This day, Advent 4, you can read the back of your bulletin, it tells you that, or the front of your bulletin, I believe, it tells you that Advent 4 is the first Sunday, or the first time during this season of Advent, that we actually talk about what we would call the Christmas incarnation. We've had various sorts of appearances or advents of God show up to us throughout this season of Advent. We're looking for the advent of Christ to come again. We talk about the advent of Christ among us in the preaching of the word. And we talk about the advent of Christ and the sacraments and the advent of Christ in the faces and the lives of one another. But today, we remember the advent of Christ once among us as one who was like us, a human being. And it's the first time in this season of Advent that we come to that. But it isn't yet Christmas. We're on a threshold. Today, even though it might seem like a little mini Christmas with this story from Mary, we still wait. And with Mary, we might wonder. We might be, as it says, perplexed by what all this might mean. What all this might mean. And so this time, this season of Advent, is a time for us to embrace both the wonderment and the beauty that is this relationship that we have with God. Because sometimes, as much as I stand up here and talk to you about it, as much as we talk about it ourselves, it's almost impossible to describe and just to simply appreciate the wonder and the beauty of the relationship that we have as the Holy Spirit intercedes for us with when we have sighs that are too deep for groaning, so too that we might have situations in our relationship with God where we find that we can't fully express what it is. And so we are just left perplexed and in wonder at the true beauty of this relationship that we have with God. So I invite you today, as we explore a bit of what it means to embrace this beautiful thing that we have with God, this relationship, to think about that and perhaps be okay with a little bit of wonderment, a little bit of amazement, and a few unanswered questions as we go through our relationship and our life with God. Would you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So we're past the 2-year mark that I was called to be your pastor, and I remember that you, when you called me, I remember telling you one of the chief reasons that I wanted to come to New England was the weather. In particular, the Christmas weather, or the winter weather. And if we look outside, what we see right now, I hope that everyone can see, but it's very white out there. It's very white, because there's lots of snow. There's lots of snow, and I love the snow, okay? I love the snow. And it's beautiful. Although Jeff told me in a couple of weeks it'll be all brown and ugly. It'll be all brown and ugly. But even that has a certain beauty about it, too. But to look out and see the snow, particularly right after it's snowed, it's very beautiful. But have you ever looked at a snowflake, one snowflake underneath it? They sometimes show you under a microscope a snowflake. Sometimes they're not very pretty. They're kind of scary looking. They look like those little bugs and stuff whenever they show you the microscope or the blown up version of those bugs. So Mike, are these beautiful snowscapes are made up of millions and billions and trillions of these snowflakes. So we look out and we see this beautiful scene of snow. It's made up of individual, ordinary, simple snowflakes. Something great and beautiful comes out of something that would seem rather simple and insignificant when we first look at it. You guys also know that I love music. Music is a something I just can't describe, again, talking about words, not being able to describe it somehow. Music is such a moving experience. But music is interesting in its own right because a single sound by itself isn't necessary. It could be impressive as a sound wave moving through the air. But a single sound by itself isn't as glorious as something whenever it's brought together. Marsha, why don't you play for us a couple of notes just by themselves? That's nice enough, right?
Yes.
Okay. But they're individual sounds. There's nothing terribly fantastic about that. But when we arrange those sounds and group them together, put them together in chords in the first position or second position or third position, root position or augmented sevenths and so forth, and we arrange them in particular ways, something beautiful comes out of it. You've got an arrangement of those notes and chords, maybe inversions and second inversions. Look at that too. Beautiful. We all know what that is, right? We know that sound. It's beautiful. And we can arrange these little sounds together into beautiful symphonies. We can listen to the birds and the trees and analyze that and see how those different sounds come together. Sound, music, a beautiful orchestration, if you will, of things coming together, little individual pieces that when brought together make something beautiful for us to appreciate. Life is full of individual pieces. The great thinkers of the past, the scientists in ancient Greece talked about the little parts of life, the atoms that make up life. And light comes about, and it's little photons that go through the world. I was talking to Michael. Well, your family's getting a lot of shout outs today. I was talking to Michael. We were talking about what is matter and what is energy. And matter is organized energy, and energy is disorganized matter. I told him I would put it into a sermon someday, and it fits today. It really fits because on one hand, we have these little pieces of energy, light. Little pieces of energy that whenever they're just bouncing around doing their own thing, they're disorganized. They don't really do much. But when they come together and they become organized, we have matter. We have the stuff of life. And so we have both energy and matter, and together they're important. Separately they're important, but when they come together, they mean something for us. And they put together this wonderful world that we have. And I'm no scientist, and even the scientists don't always know everything that's going on with these things, but they're studying it and they're coming to a deeper understanding of these things in the world that we see, and these little pieces that come together to make everything that we call the universe. It's really, truly wonderful, amazing. And I have to stand or sit or just consider, marvel at everything that God has made and the true beauty of these little pieces that come together like a snowscape, little pieces, snowflakes coming together to blanket the world in white, little individual sounds coming together to give us a beautiful hallelujah chorus of praise to God. Disorganized energy coming together, becoming organized to give us the entire world as we know it. That is a wonderful thing. Truly awesome, amazing, something that we can stand in awe and marvel at. So we have God that comes up with this plan. Can make this stuff, bring it together. Remember at the beginning, the first thing God says is, let there be light. We have that disorganized energy, and God brings it together and organizes it. Let there be light. So God, right away in the beginning, organizes this energy, brings it together, make something beautiful come out of chaos, come out of darkness, come out of confusion, come out of nothingness. And so, as we look at our own lives, and we look at this story from of Mary, where the angel shows up, I have to remember that, and we all do well to remember, that what was going on at this time was a bunch of confusion, a bunch of chaos. The world that Mary and Joseph would have known, Elizabeth and Zechariah and all of their compatriots in the Palestinian province of the Roman Empire, was one of chaos, one of, in fact, oppression for the people who were conquered by the Romans. They weren't ruled very justly in the eyes of, in their eyes. The Romans thought it was just, but they didn't feel that it was just. This was their promised land taken away from them. And so, as we hear these words spoken, that he shall be called, how does it say? He shall be called the Most High. That's an interesting expression. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. Imagine hearing those words whenever you're feeling like you are oppressed by a political power. And we're not just talking politics here in the same way that Democrats and Republicans. This is a politics that fundamentally changes the way that your life operates. Because let us not forget that the emperor, Caesar Augustus, wanted to be called Lord. He was a god on earth in his eyes, and he demanded that allegiance. So to say that the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David restores the kingdom of Israel, but it also challenges the emperor, and goes further. It challenges at a fundamental level the structures of the world that are happening around them at the time. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever. That's Israel. Jacob's name was changed to Israel after he wrestled with God. And of his kingdom, there will be no end. This is Jesus, the one whom God sends to save. But we all know how the story goes on. Jesus is born as an infant child. He doesn't come as a great king. And we know how the story ends. Jesus is crucified, and everyone, before he was resurrected, thought it was over. This promise, it fell flat. But what really happened is it didn't pan out the way that people expected it to pan out. They looked at ordinary things. They looked at ordinary things. They looked at a single G on a piano that sticks. It says, how could that ever be part of something beautiful? How could that ever be part of something? Or perhaps thinks that something beautiful is completely different than what is truly beautiful. So when we step back and we wonder and we marvel at what God has done, sometimes we need to be open to answers that might be different than what we expect. Jesus was an answer to the prayer. The prayer of Hannah, who came about early, and the prayer of Mary and Joseph and all of her people in Israel. But it wasn't the answer that people expected. But it was truly beautiful. It was truly beautiful. When you step back and you look at it and you marvel at it and you say, well, we expected a great king. But we got one who is like us. We got one who comes to us in the simplicity and the ordinariness of life. We got one who is small like us. We have one who by himself might seem insignificant, but when brought together with the power of God, can work great and mighty acts. And that same power is poured out on us. Because Jesus comes as a promise for us. And that's actually perhaps the most perplexing thing about the entire story here. God greets us as well. The Lord is with you. The Lord be with you, I say to you. Greetings. God greets us in Jesus day in and day out. When we look outside and we see this beautiful snowscape, we see that God prepares a beautiful world for us. When we look at or listen to music, we know that God has designed a world that comes together full of beauty and wonderment for us to marvel at how much God loves us, signs of God's gracious love. And so when God organizes the disorder of our life and decides and chooses to enter our life in Jesus, we can't do anything but marvel at that because it brings order. And when we incorporate that into our own lives, when the Holy Spirit indicts us and brings us together, individuals in the body of Christ, great and wonderful, beautiful things can happen. I think about what's been going on here during the pandemic at Emmanuel. The way that even though we're apart, we're still together. God's Holy Spirit is taking us individually and binding us together in our separation, creating organized energy amongst us so that indeed we matter. I think about in light of the fire, something that would cause disorganization, literally breaks things down into individual disparate parts, ashes. And we rise up again because of the power of the Holy Spirit that binds us together. Out of that disorganized energy, God has created organized energy in us. Organized for the mission that we share, of sharing God's love with ourselves. And we know when we get ourselves put together fully, that we will be organized and energized for the mission that God calls us to do. And that truly is something to marvel at. So when God enters into us, when God enters into our lives and brings order out of chaos, we can bring order out of chaos because God has empowered us. Something as simple as bread and wine, God's body and blood, empowers us to go out. And we know that we have been nourished and taken God into us. A part of God resides within us. We've been anointed with the Holy Spirit through the water and the word and baptism. Something as simple as water ties us together with one another and with God. The preaching of the word and the reading of scripture from this pulpit, simple little words, create trust and hope and strength in our relationship, that indeed nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. God is with us, Emmanuel, and that is our strength. That is our strength. We are strong, Emmanuel strong. God organizes us. God brings us together, us little simple people, and creates something grand, glorious, and beautiful out of us. For the sake of Jesus Christ and his mission in the world, his reconciliation, his love, his mercy, we are called to bear that. And God brings us together, organizing us in our chaos, bringing us and giving us energy so that we matter, so that we matter. Let us wonder, let us marvel at this glorious work that God is doing as we stand on the threshold of God's true incarnation among us at Christmas. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need.
Let us pray for the universal Church of God, especially for bishops Jim and Elizabeth, and all pastors, deacons, missionaries, and teachers, that they may be empowered with the Lord's divine knowledge to reach the people in need of instruction according to principles cited in the Scriptures on how to conduct their daily existence to achieve salvation upon life's end on earth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for God to impart wisdom to all workers on earth, to wisely utilize its resources, that is, forests, lakes, rivers, soil, birds, fish, and animals, to nourish the people of this planet to avoid sickness, famine, and disaster. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for equality to all races of people with regard to justice, peace, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. May our Lord instill in world leaders with power to ensure these essential aspects of life are available to everyone, regardless of color and their religion and political preference. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the poor, sick, bereaved, jobless, for those in need of rehabilitation from drug addiction, mental disorder, or other maladies, especially Jeannie Jones, Susan Clausen, Heidi Richard, Lori Fasano, Josh Fasano, Jean Nimi, Michelle Gasparo, Glenn Carter, and those we name aloud now.
Mariah, Betty, Lori, Hunter, Alyssa.
That they may find comfort from our Lord and not lose faith in the scriptural passage that all things work for good for those who trust in God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for the faithful departed that they are enjoying eternal life with the Lord as promised by the Scriptures, for the fruits of their labors during their lives on earth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for our church, Emmanuel Lutheran, during this difficult time due to the COVID-19 pandemic and recent fire. Lord, guide our church leaders to make good decisions as necessary during restoration processes so that all of us members once again will be able to praise your holy name together in the renovated sanctuary. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Into your hands, gracious Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting only in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Patience and hope as we care for all those in need until the coming of your Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will all make all things new again. In the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. You sent your Son, the great day spring from on high, your eternal word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord, to redeem us and all people from our bondage, forever and into eternity, loosing the shackles of Satan's tyranny. In the night before he fulfilled this great destiny, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering your great mercy toward us in Christ's life, death, and resurrection, Almighty Father, we look now with great expectation to his promised coming again, as even now we proclaim the mystery of faith. By your Spirit, sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, and us as we partake them, your Son's body and blood. Through Christ, and in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and until you come again,
we profess your resurrection. Come, Lord Jesus.
This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Lord, now let your servant go in peace.
Your word has been fulfilled.
My own eyes have seen your salvation,
a light to reveal you to the nations,
and the glory of your people Israel.
Amen.
O Father in heaven, you humble yourself and deign dignify us and all creation with your awesome glory. Nourished with the body and blood of your Son, ignite within us a sense of wonder at your love for us, and send us into the world to be witnesses to your mercy. In the strong name of Jesus.
Amen.
And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you today and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
peace. Keep watch and wait. God is with us.
Thanks be to God.